Welcome to this chat on creative commerce and how to build brands through the power of new experiences. So before we get into it, let's do some introductions. First of all, this is Marco Berzera. He is the executive creative director at VMLY&I Commerce, my colleague and good friend. Before that, he's led lots of senior creative leadership roles at some of the best agencies like DDB, Crispin Porter, JWT Tribal, and most recently has come from a client-side creative leadership role at Specsavers, where he was helping lead creative transformation in that business. He's been well awarded across all of the kind of creative shows from Cannes to Clio's DNAD, so what better individual to join me to chat about creativity? Welcome, Marco.
Oh, thank you. I don't know if my mom will do a better introduction, right? So thank you, Tom. Very generous.
Well, if she's like my mom, not often with the compliments. So, and I'm Tom Moore, head of commerce at VMLY&I Commerce, responsible there for leading transformation for clients in the commerce space, and particularly a focus on how creativity can be a real catalyst for change across kind of retail channels. So with that, let's kind of get into it. I think looking at creativity and commerce, I guess for a lot of clients, a lot of businesses and brands and retailers, growth is ever harder to kind of find. And that's bringing into sharp focus commerce as a channel to go, how can we get closer to consumers? How can we get closer to shoppers? And how can we bring creativity in that space to really kind of drive that change? So if commerce channels are becoming ever more important, I think it leads us to the question going, Marco, can creativity really turbo boost e-commerce? And actually, before we get to that, what the hell is kind of creative commerce?
Yeah, I like this question. Well, I think the first question is yes, and I'm not going to get deep on that. But I think when we think about creative commerce and what is creative commerce, it's about creativity that inspires conversion in a moment. And when we think about creativity, think about new ways of thinking and how you can drive different ways of doing the same thing. So creative commerce has this power of transformation.
Amazing. And so I think if we think about that, we think probably the short answer is yes, creativity can drive a sort of turbo boost behind e-commerce. Interestingly, looking at some stats and all things being equal, of things that can kind of drive growth, whether that be the brand, whether that be media investment and price promo, the digital shelf, creativity is proven at 30% to have the greatest kind of influence on sales and on performance. So I guess with that in mind, Marco, we said you're a kind of creative genius. What are the things then that you think constitute creative commerce kind of ideas?
Well, I don't think I'm a creative genius, but here, guys, there is three things that we are going to be talking about. If you think, for example, ideas that even are out there for a while for Burger King, for example, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the case for Whopper Detour, for example, where actually they drive people away from the restaurants, going to McDonald's and ordering there to get a free Whopper, where before they were giving a free Whopper for free. You see these ideas, they have these three kind of components, or they change and convert, so they change the way they think and behave to convert more and have a trackable way of seeing the improvement. Or building the brand, how tapping into culture and behavior. So you are not only doing the transaction, but actually building more than what you could. And of course, a multiplier effect that doesn't go only in one channel. If you think about multiple channels and how you're collapsing the sales funnel now, you could be in store, could be digital, and how it could be everywhere. So I think this is the power of these kind of ideas.
Wonderful. So we're going to have a look at three kind of really interesting case studies that in their own right are super interesting. They're kind of fun, but also they embody all of these kind of three things. So we're going to have a look at some videos. Hopefully you hear those. You can stick the headphones on if it becomes a bit kind of challenging. Right.
That one before.
Right. So first area I think is kind of super interesting and a big kind of topic of kind of conversation in the industry at the moment around the rising cost of returns. We've kind of seen H&M announce this week it's going to start charging for returns. Other brands ASOS has vehemently kind of defended its free returns policy, but it's coming under pressure. We've seen a lot of work from brands and retailers in kind of UX, looking at pricing models, subscription options, other ways to kind of mitigate that cost. But I wonder, Marco, do you think kind of creativity might be the answer?
No, I think for sure. And I think if we think about how is the behavior and how people behave in different situations, and I think one of the biggest challenges for e-com is actually this tactile thing that we have with our what we are selling and how the consumer. I remember in the beginning of the e-commerce saying that I felt that shoes will never be able to cut through e-commerce, and we look today how much we sell on those things. So I think we are going to see a case here of a French retail that I love, and I think it could answer some of these questions, and we are going to talk about it. So there's a little video, I hope you guys enjoy.
Love it, great case. I definitely clocked you dancing there as well, Marco, as we were kind of going through. So, but fantastic case. This is not one of ours, but we love it. It was awarded well at Cannes, and you're seeing some amazing kind of stats on screen there. The impact it had on returns rate, actually, I guess being the key kind of measure there. But I love this case. But Marco, like, clearly there's a QR code at the center of that. Like, it looks to me like it's just a kind of QR code. Where's the kind of creativity, do you think?
Oh, I was looking at everyone here and a lot of smiles. I don't know if it was because of the song or the idea, but actually the answer is on that, right? It's not about the QR code, but everything that is around that, right? So the behavior. What they are doing is actually hacking a behavior, paying attention to that, and building bridge. I think if you look about the collaboration with a hotel to do that, it's much more of the QR code, although it's not like having a QR code on a corner of a banner or a corner of an ad that we will have. It's actually the QR code being part of a complete and experience, right?
Yeah, I get that, but surely the QR code there, it's a buy now. Is that the bit that's kind of driving the success, or you think there's more behind it?
No, there is more behind it, but I think basically what we are saying is that when you look at La Redoute, and I'm practicing my French here.
It's coming on brilliantly.
Oh, thank you. So what I thought was amazing about that, and we were talking about that, is the experience around. And I'm sure that after this, buying that, we buy so many times, the buy button is everywhere for us. But I'm sure that people who had this experience will remember which one was the brand, where they had the contact with the brand, and how was the experience. So it's memorable.
Love it. So if we had to take one thing away from this case, what would you say that is?
Well, I think it's right time and right place, right? So I think when we think about behavior, in this case, what was amazing, the insight is thinking, where my consumers will be. It could be, guys, if it was the first briefing, probably the first answer that a lot of us will think it's, let's make a pop-up shop, right? And how many of us thought about doing something like that? But actually, sometimes you can make a collaboration with another brand that will deliver the place for you to interact. So that's what I think it's amazing.
Brilliant. Go again.
Okay.
Clickety click. Oh, hang on. No,
one before.
No, it's working. We'll come back one. Slowly, slowly.
Oh, yeah.
There we go. So this second area, I think it's kind of really interesting going, look, how do brands really kind of acquire new consumers? And you've seen a massive rise in the space of kind of performance marketing, and that kind of, I guess, endless loop that brands are kind of finding themselves in of kind of driving acquisition through media, constant kind of retargeting, and the exponential, inflation that's kind of coming in that. Do you think that that's the most efficient way to kind of drive acquisition, or do you think there's another way?
Oh, for sure there is other ways, right? And we are going to talk about it. And honestly, there is nothing wrong as well in buying media and do what we've been doing all the time, right? What I think it's interesting is if you can find different ways of actually drive exponential gains on that, right? Because we were talking before about the buy button and all this, how you can aggregate more to that. We have some friends in New York that work with us, is the same team in commerce, and they had one great idea for Oreo. You guys had a sneak peek before. You're going to see the case now, and I think it's one of the best ones, tapping into culture.
Okay.
Black and white, the most popular colorway in the shoe world. The official name of this color style? Oreo. Yep, just like our cookies.
Recently released a new Oreo collection. These are going by the nickname the Oreos.
The Oreo.
Oreo.
For years, sneakerheads have been taking our name for free. So if they hijack our stuff, we hijack their sneakers. Oreo Stuff Sneakers. A unique commerce experience that turns Oreo sneakers into Oreo cookies. This is how it works. Access OreoStuffScan.com. Scan any Oreo sneaker and turn it into a 2-for-1 cookie voucher. Redeemable at Target.com or any Target store.
Call in all Oreo lovers, and Oreo has new
AR experience that's super easy to redeem.
Oreo Stuff Scan.
Scan any Oreo sneaker.
If you have any Oreo sneakers, you can now turn them into Oreo cookies.
By recognizing color and shape, we turned every sneaker into our coupon. Even the ones in stores and on websites.
Lovely. Another great case. And hopefully we'll get some stats up in a minute. But Marco, what do you think we can, what can we learn from this case study?
Well, I know that you love this one, right? And what I think it's amazing about that is I didn't know, for example, about all these sneakerheads culture in calling Oreos the black and white sneakers, right? What I think it's interesting here is that, look, we could just go and pay for influencers and put it our product in social media. But actually here, we are hacking them. We are being part of the conversation. We are not pushing and forcing ourselves in the conversation. We are allowed to be in the space. And by doing that, you see that you connect in a different level. Actually, you are not only giving a coupon, you're giving a whole experience.
Amazing. And I think interesting about this one is it's kind of jumping from the digital world into the physical world, back into the digital world. How important do you think that kind of mix of channels is when building kind of creative commerce ideas?
Well, I think everyone knows now how is these omni-channels and the collapsing of everything. And actually, you see people going to online, to actually choose and buy in store and the other way around, right? So the behavior of the consumer is much more interesting and complex. I think what is amazing about this kind of ideas is this multiplier effect that we spoke before, by going to one channel to the other, but actually gamifying an experience and involving all the touch points that you could have. I think it's amazing.
Cool. So what would you say then from this case study is the one thing we should kind of take away?
Tapping into culture. I think the most important part of that latest study case, not this one and not this one, was into tapping into culture. So every time a brand, a product has the opportunity to go and be part of the conversation, open your ears, listen to your audience, you're going to get amazing results.
Brilliant. I'm loving this clicker. It's a lucky dip what slide we end up on. So let's see where we go to next. So the third area, I think if we're fast, we'll kind of get through is
Hunger Station, the leading food delivery app.
Back.
Next time I click.
Yeah. So I think, look, we all know, it's no kind of secret, look, the rise of technology, huge kind of advancements, everything from kind of AI onwards, having a huge kind of influence, I think, on that customer experience. And I wonder how much actually is the technology now leading that customer experience versus creativity?
It's not binary, right? I think when we think about technology, we have to think, well, first of all, technology is already a creative way of thinking, right? But I think how we adopt technology and how we make it seamlessly part of the experience. Let's think, for example, can it start from insight and lead to technology? I think yes. Well, we have a saying like, you eat with your eyes. First, you eat with your eyes. The next case from our friends from Saudi Arabia address this.
Hunger Station, the leading food delivery app and spicy innovator, wanted to ease this pressure and help people make the right choice with a smarter way to order using the power of the subconscious mind. The first ever online food delivery order placed by your subconscious mind, because it's way more powerful and can process things 500,000 times faster than the conscious mind. We decided to let it do the ordering. A feature on the Hunger Station app recognizes you've been hopelessly scrolling and launches the intuitive tool. A number of mouth-watering cuisines are displayed as the camera meticulously tracks the eye's interest using advanced algorithms and the front-facing camera. A smart AI uses proprietary food topic modeling to narrow down the options and presents a data report of what the eye concentrated on the most, or what the subconscious mind is craving, giving the user a list of relevant restaurants to order from. This innovative and intelligent feature caught the eyes of the media. We even mirrored the experience on social media, giving every Saudi the opportunity to harness the power of their subconscious. And soon, subconscious ordering became a thing.
Brilliant. Another, love it. Another beautiful kind of case study. What is it that you think that we're kind of taking out of here from a creative perspective? Is it just that kind of core insight at the beginning, or is there more beneath it?
I think there is a lot to unpack on that, right? I think, let's think about this challenge that we all have in having so many products and overload of choices, and what happens when we put all that in a basket and we don't actually finish the transaction, right? In this case here, what the beauty is that, of course, it starts with an insight, but actually all the whole experiences are, the technology is not new, guys. What is new is about the use of the technology, and I think that's what is the beauty. So they activate that when they feel, when they see that the consumers are in this consumer overload and having to choose between all these things, and actually start helping them through, and by the end just put it on the basket and helping them. And we could see that drove amazing results for them, right?
Amazing results. So you know how this works now, Marco. What's one thing you're going to take away from this case?
So, conversion is not only a transaction, right? So let's think about the whole experience and how you will engage with the consumers and how this transaction can have much more meaning and how you can actually remove friction, right? Because I think one of the biggest things about technology is instead of adding another step, Let's remove one step. Let's remove friction. Let's make life easier. And I think that's why it's so amazing.
Brilliant. Well, thank you, Marco. I think that brings us sort of nearly to time. So just to wrap up, I think three really interesting kind of case studies, all talking to some of those principles we spoke about at the beginning. They've delivered kind of measurable action, and in so doing, they've built the brand, really helped the brand kind of build equity. And all of them have found that kind of elusive multiplier effect through kind of creativity. But if we had to sort of take away three kind of things and we were trying to action that in day-to-day operations, what does that look like? I think the first thing is, let's think about how we infiltrate culture. How can we find an insight, a bit like we did in Oreos, that is, you know, so kind of rich and interesting that you prod and you poke that, it's going to give you kind of disproportionate effect. Always think connectivity. How can we bring channels together? How can we mash up? How can we kind of collaborate? Often the best ideas are brought about through those kind of connections and collaborations between channels. And finally, deploy iconically. I think that's such a key thing, that in all of those cases, they've shown up in a way that the category's not showing up, in the way that their competition isn't kind of showing up, which gives them kind of distinctivity, not only in the marketplace, but with kind of consumers, and really resonates. So that is us for now. We are here if anyone wants to come up and ask questions. We'll be out the front. I think we're gonna move on to the next chat in a bit, but we'll be here if you wanna have a chat. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.